So friends, we'll start with a new chapter, IFRS 2, share-based payments. Now basically it splits into goods, services and employees. That means we have issued our own shares to receive goods, to receive services, or to receive services from employees, payment to the employees. Now, why was there a need for this IFRS? Now, basically, what happens is whenever you issue the shares, any expense related to issue goes to other equity, right? Now, shares were issued at a premium. Premium goes into other equity, right? Share premium, you have issued it for discount. It goes into other equity, right? You deduct it from retained earnings. Nothing goes to P&L in the form of expenses or no other asset or liability is recognized related to equity. Now, whenever there is a payment in the form of equity, we don't recognize any assets, expenses, income. So now this standard was needed. Since we are issuing our own shares, let's say to purchase goods, and goods could be of two types. You have purchased either a non-current asset or certain goods that are needed in the ordinary course of business. Certain goods that are needed in ordinary course of business. Now for these goods required under ordinary course of business, purchases should be debited, right? And purchases comes under the statement of comprehensive income, right? So purchases should be debited. Now suppose you don't debit the purchases, then what will happen? You end it transferring it to other equity. Expenses will be reduced, but sale for the goods will be recorded in the comprehensive income, so it will show a pure gain. 100% revenue will become your profit. We don't want that thing to happen, right? So that is why we always that is why the need for the standard came, that the standard said no such expenses are to be recognized in the form of purchases. For non-current asset, you'll have to recognize the property, plant and equipment. Okay, so account in financial statement or financial position statement, that is balance sheet in short. Ordinary course of business, account in P&L, I would write it down. We generally call it other comprehensive income. For services, it said you'll have to account it as expense over the period services received. Over the period the services received. Then came the next question of recognition. Fine, you told us how you have to account, but what is the amount that we should consider? Book value of the shares issued, fair value of the shares issued, fair value of the goods received. What exactly is the price that we have to consider? Now, whenever we talk about the fair value of the share, it keeps changing. You want to acquire a company's listed shares just for trading purpose, you will take up the listing price. But if you want to take the control, the price offered will be different, right? You have to purchase some company, some other company, and you are going to issue your own shares to that company. There are various methods of valuation. You are valuing that company based on PE model, price earning model. Your share will also be valued at price earning model. You want to value them company as cash flow model, present value of future cash flow generated. Your share price will also be valued at present value of future cash flow generated, and each of them will have a different fair value, right? So share, we cannot determine the fair value because there are so many methods to determine the fair value of the shares. It becomes a bit difficult to determine the correct exact fair value of the shares. That is why in all these cases, what our IFRS tells us is that you should take into consideration fair value of goods or services received. Fair value of the goods or services received, and that is how you are going to account for under IFRS 2. Employees I have kept altogether separate. That is the main topic that we have to discuss, but this is the general accounting practice that IFRS 2 tells you, and this is the part that students should be familiar with for IFRS examination. Because the employee part is mostly asked under the consolidation question. They are comparatively very easy, not that difficult to understand. Even these parts are very easy, but these can be asked separately. You cannot expect a share-based payment question to be asked separately other than from consolidation in the remaining questions. Okay, so I'm just telling you a strategy on how you should prepare for your IFRS examination. Okay, we will just discuss certain questions related to these goods, on the valuation of these goods. In the book that I gave you, their questions are at the end related to goods and services. We look at this question number 21. Indian Inc. issued 995 shares in exchange for purchase of office building. So there is a goods, non-current asset that we have purchased. Title has been transferred in the name of Indian Inc. on Feb 2001 and the shares were issued. Fair value of the building is 2 lakh. Fair value of the share is 100. So if I multiply those 995 shares by 100, the value becomes 99,500. But the value of the building is 2 lakh. Are you able to understand this? Now, at what price should we account? As I told you, we always consider the fair value of the goods received. Fair value of the goods received. So you have received 2 lakh. 2 lakh will be considered. Okay? Okay, it's not fair value, it is face value. So we don't know the fair value of the shares. So now 99,500 goes to share capital and remaining amount goes to share premium. Now what if we don't know the fair value of the goods received? In that case, the only option is fair value of the shares issued. But it is the last option, last resort that we always go for. Next question, we look at service. Reliance Limited hired a maintenance company for its retail, for its oil field business. The service will be settled by issuing 1,000 shares of Reliance. Period for which the service is to be provided is from 1st April to 1st July and the fair value of the service was estimated using market value of similar contract for, you may ignore the INR, we can say currency unit, it can be any currency unit, 1 lakh. Nominal value of the share is 10, record the transaction. Now the service that we have received has a fair value of 1 lakh. So 1 lakh is what we have to account. Now you have been given April, May, June, 3 months. Suppose I want the monthly transaction to be presented. How are we going to present this monthly transaction? Make it 31st July. Just change the date to 31st July. So how are we going to present this monthly transaction? We'll split it into four parts, assuming that service is received equally in each and every month. That makes it 25,000 per month. So April 25,000, May 25,000, June 25,000, even July 25,000, provided monthly statements are required. They have asked you for the monthly statements. In such a case, these statements will be presented. So I hope you are clear with these concepts on how do we present the goods value. Now let's come up to employees. IFRS 2, why was it introduced? Why was employees introduced inside? It was a very simple concept. Why were the shares issued to the employees? It came from there. With the increasing turnover, especially in IT companies, information technology companies, what happened is companies started, instead of increasing the package of the employees, they started giving them share-based payments. They told them that you complete a particular project and then if you want to leave the company, you may leave. We will give you these many shares. Project was generally for a specified period, let's say 3 years. So they were told that you have to work for the company, let's say for 3 years. After 3 years, we will give you so and so many shares. But the commitment and the contract was signed today itself, though the shares were to be issued 3 years later. Now, certain employees may think it is like a package. Let's say you have a package of 6 lakh per annum. And there's some other company offering you a package of 8 lakh rupees per annum. So 2 lakh rupees increase. Now to retain you, company has two options, either increase the package or provide you with shares. If they increase your package to 8, company is not sure whether the other company will increase the package further or not. So it is like we offer 8, another company will again offer 9. Can be. So it's like a bidding process. So it's a lose-lose situation for both the companies. Rather what this company does is, it also comes to know about the loyalty of the employee. It says that fine, we give you certain shares which are today worth 2 lakh. Let's say this 2 lakh differential amount. But we'll not give you these shares in your hand right now. You'll have to work with us for minimum 3 years. After 3 years, if you work well, your company grows very fine, then what will happen is the share price will increase too much and you will end up earning really a very good amount, really a very good amount. So we are giving you certain shares today itself, but you cannot have, like, we are offering you shares, we are not allotting you shares, we are offering you shares today itself, but you cannot buy them, you cannot have them registered in your name until the service period defined to you of 3 years is lapsed. Once it is lapsed, then you will get these shares. I hope you got somewhat somewhere the concept. Now, if the employee feels that the price will increase drastically more than any other company is offering as a package, he will continue with the company. If he does not feel, still he will leave the company. Okay? So company, whenever gives an increase, hike in package, they expect that the employee should retain over a specified period. With increased package, companies are not sure. Lots of people do this, increase their package and then apply in another company and then switch over the job. We don't want such a thing to happen, right? So that's why share-based payment is considered to be the best option. Now, everything comes with its own flaws. Even share-based payment came up with some window dressing ideas. Certain companies thought it's a good idea. Let's start paying salary also in the form of shares to the employees. This way, as I told you, whenever the shares are issued, no expenses booked in P&L, right? So no expenses were being booked in P&L. We ended up booking not even a single expense in P&L, but all incomes were being booked. So what it leads to a very huge profit, which is not the correct picture. It leads to increase in share price. Finally, the owners of the company, what will they do? They will sell off all the shares when it reaches a peak point and then run away. And then shareholders will be left with nothing because company actually incurred expenses in the form of issue of shares, right? We don't want such a thing to happen. That is why IFRS 2 came into picture and said that no, if you are paying any employee in the form of these share-based payment, you should book the expense. You should transfer it to P&L. And if you are transferring it to P&L in the form of expense, it should be expensed over the period in which such shares are going to be issued. Over the period in which such shares are going to be issued. I hope somewhat, somewhere, this idea is clear. Now we need to understand certain terminologies related to the same. Now the date on which we offer the shares to the employee is known as grant date. And there is some share price that is going on in this date. That price is known as the share price. Now suppose it is going to be given on a specified date. That date is known as vesting date or exercise date, you can say. Now on this date, there will be some price that is being expected today and that is the expense for the company. Whenever company issues the shares, company has some price in mind. Let's say the share price will reach 30 and we have given them 3 years of period, 30. So for us that 30 is expense, but we are not going to pay it today after 3 years. So present value of that 30, let's say 25. For us to retain the employee, the expense is 25. So it is a intrinsic value. The term we use is intrinsic value. And this intrinsic value is determined on grant date. Okay. Grant date, we try to determine the intrinsic value of the share. Intrinsic value. This intrinsic value we can also consider to be the fair value. Now this vesting period, this whole period is known as vesting period. And this vesting period depends on various scenarios, various conditions, like one of the condition is service condition. You will have to continue with the company for a specified period. Second is performance condition. You will have to achieve a target. It could be production target. It could be a contract target, anything. And then the last one is market condition, which is something not within the control of the employees, like share price. Let the share price increase and reach a specified price. How is employee supposed to control that? He cannot do that. So that is known as market condition. So vesting period depends on all of them. Initially, we are concerned with service condition. We are trying to understand service condition. Then we will see questions related to performance condition. Then we'll see market condition. Okay. Now, generally these shares are offered at a offered free to the employees, that you'll have to continue for a specified period and then you can take these shares. But some companies ask for some price. You will have to pay some amount. It is like those options, call option and put option under derivatives that we read. Call option means option to buy at a specified price, right? So that price is defined today itself, that you can buy the share at this particular price. That price is known as exercise price. Okay. So we have the intrinsic value of the share, we have the exercise price of the share, the price at which the employee can purchase the share. And the difference between the two is known as fair value of option. The option given to the employee to buy the shares, right? And the difference is the expense for the company, because exercise price is something that the employee is paying, while the actual price turns out to be a bit higher. So the difference is the expense for the company. And we have to recognize that expense. It is known as fair value of the option. We don't need to worry how to determine this fair value of the option. It is used practically. We use Black and Scholes model on the basis of which this price is determined. But the fair value of the option is the expense to be recognized over the vesting period. Over the vesting period. I hope somewhat somewhere you have understood what exactly we are trying to speak of over here. Okay, so we move a bit more ahead. Vesting date is the date on which the service period is satisfied, but it is not just like, it is a date from which the employee can exercise his option. It is not the only date on which he can exercise the option. He is given certain period over which he can exercise the option. This period is known as exercise period. And it is defined. Once the employee has completed, let's say, 3 years of service, he is given 2 months to buy the share. It is not an infinite period, that since you have completed 3 years, you can buy the share anytime you want at your wish. No, we give them a specified period. You have to buy it during this period itself. Okay, so that is how it is exercised. Now, what do we call them? The terminology used is employee stock options. And how do we account for the same? We book the expense, let's say in the name of employee benefits. We debit employee benefits to employee stock options outstanding. To employee stock option outstanding. Okay. That is how we book the expense every year, amortized basis. With the question, you will be able to understand it a bit better. That is how we book the expense. Now, where does it go? The employee benefit goes to P&L, the statement of comprehensive income. And where does the ESOP outstanding go? You are going to issue shares against it, right? Your own company shares. You are obliged to issue your own shares. There is no other obligation. There is no obligation to pay cash. There is just one obligation, issuing your own shares. So, issue of shares by the company cannot be considered to be a liability. What is liability? Against which there will be future outflow of some cash, cash equivalent, or maybe some financial asset. Liability is not future outflow of your own shares. It is not a liability. So that's why this ESOP is classified under other equity. This ESOP is classified under other equity. I hope you are getting the concept, the crux of what we are doing and why we are doing it. Okay. So this is the rough idea. The terminologies that we try to understand, there may be some more terminologies that may come up. There are other patterns of payments as well that we have to discuss. But right now, initially, we are trying to understand some basic concepts. Okay. Let me discuss with you a single question related to the same, to have this basic idea. Good Luck Limited, the very first question, grants 180 shares to 690 employees. Okay, 180 shares to 690 employees. So we have given them 180 shares. Each employee can purchase 180 shares It grants a condition that employee working over the period of 4 years, provided he'll have to be in service for the next 4 years. This is service condition. You'll have to be in service for the next 4 years. Good Luck Limited has estimated that the fair value of the option is rupees 15. Now, what is this fair value of the option? Intrinsic value of the share on that date. Now, how did you find the intrinsic value? We use Black and Scholes model. What will be the fair value after 4 years? We have to issue them shares after 4 years. So what will be the fair value after 4 years? Present value of that 4 years value. Present value of that price is the expense for the company. We call it intrinsic value. How do we determine it? Black and Scholes model. I'm just giving you a rough idea. Don't compare it. If you know Black and Scholes model, don't compare it. Don't try to compare it. I'm just giving you a rough idea because we don't have to apply Black and Scholes model over here. Okay. The fair value will always be given. Or maybe intrinsic value of the share will be given. And there will be some exercise price. We have to buy the share at some price. Nothing is given over here. The difference between the two. And if there is no exercise price, this fair value of the option is the intrinsic value of the share only. 15. Good Luck also estimated that 30% of the employees will leave during the period of 4 years. What is the expense to be recognized? Now what happens is, now how the expense is booked? Do we book it in, when do we expense the book? When is the expense booked? So we have these 4 years. We have discussed every year we have to book the expense. Fine. But every year at which point? Now, this is the grant date. We offered these 160 shares to 690 employees. And each share has a fair value to be 15. Now, when do we have to book the expense? Over the period of 4 years. When? Beginning of the year or end of first year? So some of you will say beginning of first year. See, we don't book it in the beginning of the first year. We book it in the end of first year. Why? At least some service should be received from the employee. What have you received in the beginning when you gave him the offer? Now, when you gave him the offer, he is obliged to work with the company for the next 4 years. Let's say he completes 1 year of service. Then you should book some expense, right? So expense will be booked at the end of first year. They are saying that we expect 30% of the employees will leave over the period of 4 years. So let's say at the end of first year, there are some 680 employees in the company. 10 of them have already left. But we are expecting 30% to leave. So let me just deduct 30% from 690. That makes it 483. We are expecting that 483 employees will only exercise the option. That means we are expecting that over the period of 4 years, the service that we are going to receive will be from 483 employees. Service against this share-based payment. Normal service will be provided by all the employees who are going to even leave. But service against which the shares are going to be issued will be provided by 483 employees only. It is just an estimate by the management. So what should the expense be booked for, 680 employees or 483? Because the difference between 680 and 483 are those employees who have not even expected, they don't even want to work for the next 4 years. They are just there with the company waiting for a package increment. Or maybe some of them had plans, but later the plans will change. It happens. Management knows both these aspects. So they are somewhat aware that they are going to receive service only from 483 employees. So expense should be booked only for 483 employees. Now the question arises, the expectation will change at every point. At the beginning of the year, there'll be some expectation. End of the year, there'll be some expectation. Which expectation we should consider? Answer is, when are you booking the expense? End of first year. So which expectation you should take into a consideration? End of year one. This is just change in estimate, nothing else. So at the end of first year, we book certain expense. What is the expense that we book? 483 employees, 160 options with each employee. I believe it was 160 only. Oh, it was 180. Let me change it. 180. 180 employee. And the fair value is also, I believe, 15. 15. Over the period of 4 years. That makes it 3,26,025 of expense to be booked at the end of first year, also at the end of second year, third year, fourth year. Sir, you told us that the expectations may change, right? But in the very first question, nothing like this is given. So we are going to book this equal expense in all the 4 years, right? We are going to book this equal expense in all the 4 years. Now there are some more facts that we need to consider. What? Fair value of the share will change at the end of first year, second year, third year, fourth year. Now what? Do we have to consider the change in price? Now there is a basic rule by IFRS 9 financial instruments. Once equity is recognized, there is some value determined for the equity. Not recognized, the value determined for equity, initial recognition. Subsequent recognition, the fair value of the equity does not change. We don't change the fair value of equity once it is initially recognized. The logic is, for management, grant date is the date on which they offered to the employees. Now they cannot change the offer. They would have kept lots of things in mind. What if the share price increase above a particular level they are expecting? Or it does not reach that point, it is below. So if it reduces, management will be happy. If it increases, management will be sad. Management is least bothered because they don't have to pay cash, try to understand. They have decided what are the shares they have to give. They had some price in mind. They knew that the price may increase, may decrease, doesn't matter. These are the shares that we offer. We don't offer anything more, anything less. So while deciding on number of shares, they had some price in mind. Randomly the shares were not decided. So the price in their mind was 15 rupees, right? Now can they change it at the end of first year? They may increase it, they cannot reduce it. They can increase the number of options I've given to the employees. We are going to talk about these terms later, modification of share-based payment. Ignore. They have offered these many shares, these are the only shares that they have to offer. So offer price will be 15 itself. Now what about increase in employees? What if actually the employee turn out to be more than 483? So it doesn't matter. No, it is change in estimate. Doesn't matter. Change in estimates are accounted subsequently. We are going to see how change in estimates are as well dealt with. I am trying to just explain you over here the logic behind how we are booking the expenses. And I hope that part of logic is somewhat somewhere clear. And how, what is the entry we pass? Employee benefits debit to ESOP. Employee stock options outstanding. Employee stock option outstanding goes to other equity and employee benefits goes to P&L. That is what happened at the end of first year, at the end of second year, third year and fourth year. Okay. I hope the concept is somewhat understood. We will deal with some enhanced questions from next video. So I end this video over here. Thank you.